Hello and welcome to official Xbox 360 Magazine's OXM Report. And this week we're talking to veteran game designer American McGee about Alice Madness Returns and its twisted vision of Wonderland.
Cool, so I'm here with American McGee, who's the creative director on Alice Madness Returns. This isn't your standard sort of children's bedtime story, Alice, right?
No, absolutely. I mean, this is a very dark and twisted reimagining of the original books. And of course, it's an Alice that's had some pretty traumatic events happen in her life, which have created this new line of history for the franchise and for the story and the characters that everyone knows.
I think in terms of the story and perhaps interpretations of it in the past, people feel like they have a pretty good idea of what Wonderland looks like. So how do you kind of make this version your own?
Well, actually, I think that the way we imagine Wonderland, of course, was first inspired by the Tennille drawings, the illustrations in the books. But then I think a lot of people think of Disney when they think of Wonderland. When we came to it, though, we really kind of opened that question back up again and built a new interpretation, which when I've talked to people, in the film industry, the games industry, a lot of people who now, you know, view this as the definitive vision for what Wonderland and what Alice should look like. A lot of it really had to come from the character of Alice. I mean, we put her in our story through some pretty traumatic events, and because everything that you see in Wonderland is a function of her imagination and her psychology, that really drove this new visual interpretation of Wonderland.
So for people who didn't maybe play the old game and aren't familiar with your version of the story, tell me about what Alice has been through and where she finds herself at the start of this game.
Well, the first game dealt with an event, which was a fire that destroyed her home and killed her family and landed her in an asylum, which when the game began, she'd been there for 10 years and had been struggling and sort of rejecting all forms of treatment. And there's a moment where it's clear that either she's going to solve this problem of the psychological damage that she suffered, or she's going to suffer a lobotomy and be stuck there for the rest of her life. And so the clock starts ticking, and then she, of course, enters into Wonderland and uses that as a tool whereby she's exploring the emotions and the damage that came out of this traumatic event and trying to put the pieces back together so she can save herself and exit from the asylum. That was the first game. Now, the second game is a narrative sequel to that, so it finds her now outside of the asylum in London, but still trying to piece together some of the mystery that is wrapped around that night.
And one of the ways she'll be dealing with that is a lot of hacking and shooting and things. Tell me about the tools she has at her disposal.
Well, she is an action character, and because of the violent nature of the events that she's dealing with, she needs to have a very kind of cathartic, very visceral way of dealing with the problems that she encounters inside of this mental landscape. This time, we've armed her with four weapons. They are kind of broken up by ability and speed. We almost kind of see them as keys which you use to unlock combat with specific NPCs. So there's a Vorpal Blade, which is her sort of iconic traditional weapon. There's a Pepper Grinder, which if people played the first game, they saw was originally in the hands of the Duchess. There's a Teapot, which of course takes its origins from the Hatter's Domain. And then finally there's a Hobby Horse, which is sort of a throwback to the concept of toys as weapons, which we had in the original product. And as I said, I mean, each one of them has its own sort of, you know, pluses and minuses and rhythm and timing to it. So the player really has to try to learn how to use these weapons in concert and with a particular style against any given enemy they come across.
Obviously, you famously worked at id Software, right? I mean, how has game development changed since those days?
It's changed in so many ways. When we were working on the original Doom and Quake titles, there were 9 people in total making these giant game products and, you know, having to build the technology from scratch and build all the design. And I mean, of course, these days, if you look at something like Alice, we had a core of 70 people inside our studio, another 45 people doing asset production externally. So, you know, over 100 people building the product. And so, I mean, just in the sense of scale that, you know, you have going into these products these days, there's obviously a major change. But I think also one of the things that we really appreciate about developing now is that the tool sets have become so much more mature. We don't have to spend time building an engine. We work with the Unreal 3 engine, which means that we can spend a lot more time focused on the content and the quality of the game.
Obviously, it's a long time since the original Alice game. Is this a sequel a long time in the making?
Well, you could say that when we finished the first game, we already had ideas to continue the franchise. But at that time, you know, 11 years ago now, the opportunity didn't present itself. And so, you know, some time passed, and myself and my creative partner, RJ Berg, who was with me on the first game, you know, we kind of kept it in the back of our minds that we would return to it someday. And when EA came and offered us the chance, it, you know, sort of opened back up again all of our thinking about where we might take the character. And you know, always what was central to that was the sort of mystery, the solving of this fire that killed her family.